Welcome back, class. For this session, we're going to talk about Baroque art. So we're in the 17th century, and to keep it within reasonable limits, we're gonna keep it to Italy. Basically, be in Rome for the whole first part of this class. So the Baroque. We'll start with a term, as we often do. So the Baroque. The term Baroque comes from the Portuguese word for misshapen pearl. And this might seem strange at first, but I want you to think of it as an analogy or a metaphor. So the idea goes that the High Renaissance was this moment of perfection. And so many art historians, starting with Vasari all the way back in the 16th century, deemed the High Renaissance to be basically the perfection of the visual art. And so the idea is that the High Renaissance then is this perfect, round, beautiful pearl, right, that everybody wants to wear. Well, maybe not everybody wants to wear, but that people sort of privilege and prize as jewelry, as this beautiful thing. The Baroque then would be the misshapen pearl in this analogy. And that's not a coincidence, because when we look at the Baroque, it's definitely coming from a High Renaissance aesthetic. You'll see a lot of things that are similar or that come from Michelangelo or that come from Raphael or come from Leonardo. But it's often an exaggerated version of the High Renaissance aesthetic. It's a deviation. And of course, some deemed it to be a perversion. Hello, Jax. That it lacked symmetry, that it wasn't as beautiful as the High Renaissance. So that's more or less one of the reason, the best guess as to why Baroque is called Baroque, right? So we can actually trace the beginnings of a Baroque look or a Baroque aesthetic of this High Renaissance that sort of started deviating from itself, not on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel, which we studied last week and so many of you seem to really enjoy, but actually a work that Michelangelo did much later in his career, but it's in the same room, and it's his Last Judgment from 1536 to 41. So it's not on the ceiling, it's at the far room, and it's a pretty incredible painting. So here it is, it's hard to take in. So one of the first things you notice that's so different from the ceiling that you'll remember from the Sistine Chapel is that whereas that book of Genesis, the stories of Genesis, they each have their own compartment, they each have their own place, they seem to be confined in a storytelling sort of clear linear sort of way. Here, this is just a mass of bodies, this massive scene that really is hard to take in all at one look, and you're just constantly looking at all these writhing bodies that are floating in the air, flowing down, flowing upwards. It's a pretty incredible painting. So just at the level of the composition, Michelangelo here later on in this work is deviating from this emphasis on clarity, on order that we saw in the High Renaissance, and he's going towards something much more visually tumultuous and lacking clarity. And also, this is very key for the Baroque, it's much more overwhelming for the viewer. And here's some details. So look at these bodies. They just at the level of the human form itself, Michelangelo seems to be deviating from the ideals of the High Renaissance body as this beautiful, symmetrical, sort of ancient Greek kind of look to the human form. Now Michelangelo's bodies look much bigger. They're bulging, they're writhing in all sorts of different ways. Leonardo and Michelangelo were really at odds with each other. They didn't like each other whatsoever. And Leonardo at one point called Michelangelo's human figures just bags of nuts. Like these are bags filled with nuts. And I guess, you know, in some ways visually it does make sense because you have all these shapes that seem to be writhing underneath the skin of Michelangelo's figures, which of course are not nuts, but they're supposed to be muscles. But this is almost like the human body on steroids or something like this, right? I mean, it's really a deviation from the high Renaissance aesthetic. And one small little note, which I always like saying, is that while Pope Julius II was a somewhat somewhat humanist pope, somewhat more liberal, I suppose, let's put that in quotes. And nudity wasn't so much of an issue on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. Later popes were a little bit more conservative, and they saw the nudity in Michelangelo's work, and they had, this is much later on, this is after Leonardo had already passed away, they had artists come in and draw clothing. So, like, behinds would be covered up, right? You have all this clothing. I'm not sure if all of the folds, all of the clothing that's included here, that seems to be covering up all these bottoms are part of the painting over, but many of them are. So it's an interesting little moment of censorship in the church with regards to its art. So one way to emphasize that humanism and the Renaissance, it's not a linear thing in history. So there's the creation of Adam. So very different. You can tell everything is composed, well ordered. The human form is this idealized Greco-Roman. Maybe in Michelangelo already sort of a little too amped up physically, but nothing like what's going to be unfolding decades later in the Last Judgment. And so here are a couple other details from the Last Judgment. Here is Christ with Mary. So of course he's right in the center here, much larger than most of the other figures. And notice the ways in which Michelangelo has sort of distended his body, the waist, the obliques, the abs, all this stuff. It seems to be sort of moving outward as you go towards his midsection. Very, very strange in a way. If you're still thinking within the vocabulary of the High Renaissance. Here is Saint Bartholomew, also this massive muscular body with a drapery that probably was painted later on, covering him up. He's a saint, and most saints in the Catholic Church were martyred, so they were killed for their faith. And you have stories of saints and martyrdom that are important for Christians or Catholics. And Bartholomew, Michelangelo gives you a taste or a hint as to how he was martyred, how he was killed. And it's pretty ghastly. This is some Texas Chainsaw Massacre stuff here. This is his skin with his face that he's holding. And he's holding the knife that would have flayed him alive. So he was flayed. He was killed by being skinned, by being flayed alive. Of course, now this is the Last Judgment, and he's back in his own, in his new skin. But as a reminder, he's holding his old skin. And it's interesting. Some scholars have noted that actually the face of the skin that he's holding might very well be a self-portrait by Michelangelo. Michelangelo made himself this skin, which of course scholars have had a field day analyzing, thinking maybe Michelangelo, there was some sort of guilt complex or some sort of self-loathing or something going on there. I'll leave it to you to decide what that all means. And so we can already find this Baroque aesthetic in the later work of Michelangelo, and in a movement of art that we don't have time to study called Mannerism, which Michelangelo also influenced, which is in some ways related to the Baroque look. And so here we are in Rome. It's a very, very beautiful city. My mother retired in Rome, and so I visited a few times now. She had to escape Italy for obvious reasons, so she isn't there now, but hopefully one day soon she'll be back, and one day soon you'll be able to visit this really beautiful city. So where we are in Rome, we're on top of St. Peter's, so you can't really see St. Peter's so much, but you're looking out on Rome, on the Vatican, but you are seeing the colonnade that was made by a very important artist for the Baroque, which is Bernini, who we're going to study today. And so already here, just architecturally, notice how this is that misshapen pearl. These are basically Greco-Roman colonnades, groups of columns, but rather than being straight, rather than being, you know, this sort of symmetrical architectural setting, they're bubbling out, and they almost feel like arms that are embracing you. I've been in this square. It's a really beautiful beautiful square to be in, and I'm sure you've seen it in movies and all sorts of things. So you do feel as if you're being sort of hugged by this large architectural setting. So it's more than simply a building that you come up into. It's as if the building is enfolding you, is sort of gathering you up and taking you in, and that's very, very Baroque. And so this is not only an architectural style, because there's an idea behind all of these things that I'm describing. Because during Baroque Italy, during the 17th century, and of course even before, you have what's called the Counter-Reformation. So you all know what the Reformation was. Protestants, beginning with Luther in 1517, are pushing back against the church, and ultimately the church splits. So this is the Protestant Reformation, right? Which was all about austerity, about simplicity, in some cases even iconoclastic simplicity, destroying images, even musical instruments. The Protestant austerity would be against Roman Catholic ostentation, right? So this glamorous, large-scale, very visual, Catholic visual culture, that's part of the Baroque. So the Baroque is a counter-reformation, and it's using the visual arts and architecture as a way to push back against the Protestant Reformation. And so this is why the style of the Baroque is often very intense, it's often very dramatic, and it's almost always trying to overwhelm the viewer or the listener. I'm going to play you some Baroque music today, because this is some of the greatest music ever written in history. The aesthetic of the Baroque is always trying to be intense, dramatic, and overwhelm the viewer. And this is not just simply to overwhelm the viewer. This is as a way to sort of emotionally implicate the viewer to either stay with the church or to come back, right? To come back and not to become part of the Reformation, not to become, let's say, a Protestant. And there were wars being fought at this time between Protestants and Catholics, very horrible, devastating wars, wars of religion. And so along these lines, what's compatible here is that you also in the Baroque have this major interest in conversion stories and saints like Saint Bartholomew that we just saw, which would equally seek to inspire piety and fidelity to the Catholic Church in its viewers, in the faithful. So conversion stories and saints, they're gonna come fast and furious in many of these examples that we look at in the Baroque. So, like I was saying, Bernini is very important. He's the artist, architect, sculptor, painter, a favorite of the Pope. He was very good with the Pope during this period in Rome. He's the one who devised this colonnade that's sort of hugging the public space on the Vatican. Above all, Bernini was a master sculptor. He's quite incredible. Some of the best sculpture you could actually hope to see. This is a somewhat earlier work of his called Damned Soul. So this is a person that's been thrown to hell, screaming as if he's already in the fire and brimstone, feeling all this pain. And so right off the bat, you can tell that this sculpture is incredibly dramatic, emotive. It's trying to elicit a response from you. And the Baroque will often be sensuous. So, and I mean that in the broadest sense, like sensuous in the sense of like skin, nerve endings, you know, the stuff that when you see, if you see an image of violence or something like that, even if it's in a horror movie or something like this that you know is not real, you'll get this weird sort of shock. Maybe something like going up and down your spine or a weird tingling. There's something about the Baroque. They're very much, it's an aesthetic that's very tapped into that very visceral sort of a response to what you're seeing. And Bernini takes this really far in this work. So the bust itself, this portrait of this damned soul, looks like he's writhing, screaming in pain, almost as dramatic as possible. And to get this, Bernini actually posed for this. He was in front of a mirror and probably doing sketches to studies for this eventual sculpture. And he would put his hand on a fire. So he would basically burn himself to feel actual pain on his skin. So he would really be screaming in the mirror so that he could get this really authentic scream in this damn soul. So that's really going as far, that's really going very far for your art. I think you might agree with me, and pretty intense, pretty dramatic, so very, very Baroque. Here's a somewhat later work, is David. So we've seen a number of Davids now, and I think I bring in some comparison for you, yes. So note, Bernini, these are both made of marble, but Bernini is safely within a Baroque world, whereas this earlier Michelangelo is safely within the Renaissance world. And again, in class, this would be a moment where I would stop and I would ask as many students as possible to compare these two works and to say why one is visually tied to the High Renaissance and why the other is so tied to the Baroque. And we often have really nice discussions about this. So one of the things is the more dynamic composition of the Bernini, the Baroque, where it looks like he's in mid-action. So he sacrificed this sort of beautiful, timeless symmetry of contrapposto, of just standing there, of David, Michelangelo's David. I think we could say he was really feeling himself. You don't have that much. That's sacrificed in Bernini's version, where he's really trying to get to the action. And so, whereas you have this sort of horizontal, vertical composition of Michelangelo's David, the Bernini is more on the diagonal axis. So the composition, oftentimes in the Baroque, will be this sort of diagonal axis, which is usually more dramatic, which usually gives more of a sense of movement. His face, the features all look more dramatic. It's in fact the more dramatic moment in the story. So Donatello's, you'll remember his David is after the battle. You'll remember that Michelangelo is before the battle. Bernini seems to be giving it to you like mid-battle. So he's in the process of throwing the stone with his sling to slay Goliath. So this is very Baroque, a Baroque iteration of this very famous story of David and Goliath. Bernini's probably most famous and celebrated work is The Ecstasy of Saint Teresa, which I show you here. And it's a statue, but it's more than just a statue, which is why I show it to you in the space. This is the Coronaro Chapel in Rome. So notice, one of the key features of the Baroque, which I didn't talk about when I was introducing to you, but it will make a lot of sense, is that if the Baroque is trying to overwhelm you, what's the best way to do it? The best way to do it is not just use one type of artwork, like a sculpture, or a painting, or music, or architecture, but to use all of them in tandem, to synthesize them all into one large work that then will be completely overwhelming because it's giving you all these different media and it's working on all your different senses. So this is a really wonderful example of this, because here we are in the Coronaro Chapel. This is Bernini's sculpture right in the center. And don't worry, we're going to zoom in imminently here. But I do want to show you the context, because you have all this incredibly rich, beautiful marble, all these architectural features. We have painting. We also have ironwork in the center here, these are iron bars. And behind this pediment, this architectural feature that sort of it creates this canopy or this patio for the sculpture, behind this is an actual window. So real light will come in if it's sunny outside and if it's daylight. And so he's working with all these different elements, all these different media, as a way to create this sort of synergistic work of art that, again, should overwhelm and exceed the perceptual and even cognitive limits of us as viewers. So if we go in, we see these beautiful columns here made of marble. Marble comes in all different colors and can be very, very beautiful. These are Corinthian columns. And notice, this is just the perfect example of High Renaissance, which always takes after Greek, in this case, architecture. Notice how it's bubbling out. Notice how it's like, he's even cut it here. It's almost sharp. It's sort of coming out at you. The whole thing is bubbling out. This is that perverted, misshapen pearl of the Baroque, taking the Greek and Renaissance style and sort of bending and playing with it and really physically coming out at you. And so it's important to look at that context. But of course, the most important part of this work is the Bernini sculpture itself, the Ecstasy of Saint Teresa. So she's below these iron bars, which again would symbolize golden rays of light, which would have real light emanating from the window that's hidden behind the architectural element. And this is also very Baroque, sort of hiding the theatrical elements to create this effect. So these two figures are sort of being bathed in real light and also metaphoric golden divine light through these bars. And you have an angel here holding a spear. There are wings here, right? This is the angel. And then this is Saint Teresa. So Saint Teresa was a saint who had visions, and she wrote about them. And so she was an important mystic, an important saint, especially for the Baroque. Remember, the Baroque is very much into saints as these counter-Reformation figures. And so one vision that she wrote about, that Bernini here immortalizes, is this visitation she had from an angel who lifted up the fabric of what she was wearing and began plunging a spear or an arrow right into her heart. So what you're seeing is an angel basically stabbing Saint Teresa. Saint Teresa, in writing about this vision, this episode, this visitation, she describes the arrow as this immensely pleasurable thing. It's a miracle, this divine experience, but also painful. And so there's this mix of pain and pleasure in the way she describes this episode in one of her visions. And Bernini's tried to communicate this to you in ways that actually might seem counterintuitive for Catholicism, because there are some pretty obvious sexual overtones in this statue. Her feet are curled. Her head is sort of bent back. Her eyes are closed. After all, ecstasy is another word for orgasm. Is it a word for sensual pleasure? And so she seems to be giving off that vibe of this sort of painful, pleasureful, but definitely overwhelming experience that she's undergoing. And again, that might seem counterintuitive because of so much of what we've learned about the history of Christianity. And here, in a more limited way, Catholicism, is that the body, sexuality, is definitely something that's sinful, that should be downplayed, right? And that's not unique to Christianity. But Bernini here in the Baroque is actually using it, but not in a sacrilegious way, not in an unpious way, but simply as a way to have viewers identify with this mystic, to identify with Saint Teresa herself. Because think about it, most people, I'm assuming, have no idea what it means to be visited by an angel, to have a miracle being performed on them. Most people don't. But most people do have access and do understand and can see the physical signs of sexual pleasure, of bodily pleasure, right? And then that's a way that the audience can then be drawn in, which is exactly what the Baroque is doing. So the Baroque, in some ways, way before advertisers in the 20th century understood that sex sells, the Baroque already in some ways knew that sensuality would be a way of drawing in the pious, right? So that's one way to explain why we have this somewhat sensualized rapport between Saint Teresa and this angel. And the angel is either completely psychotic, stabbing someone with this smile, this benevolent smile on the face, or understands that this is in fact like a holy act, right? This is like a divine moment, a divine visitation. So yeah, it's definitely that second that second version. So she's looking down at Saint Teresa in this really sort of benevolent, lovely kind of look. The other thing I always talk about with this sculpture is just at the level of the form. It's really quite incredible. This is all the same piece of marble that he's worked with. But notice the difference between the drapery of the angel and the wings. Notice how much more soft and diaphanous and light and unweighty it all is. In comparison to Saint Teresa, whose fabric seems to be much more heavy, this really large, like way too much drapery, way too much fabric. It's almost, it seems stiff, starchy, right? You get a palpable sense that these are two different materials, that these are two different entities. One is more ethereal and divine, while the mystic is of course, partly is a human being. He's giving you a sense of their the different quality of their existence, but with the very same piece of marble. It's quite incredible. And I've always loved this little detail. It's so delicate how the angel is holding up, either having just stabbed her or is about to stab her with the arrow. It's an incredible statue. Okay, so we now move on to painting in the Baroque. And all the same motifs are going to apply here. This is Fra Andrea Pozzo, The Glorification of St. Ignatius. It's a ceiling fresco. So what you're seeing is basically a camera taking a picture straight up at the ceiling of this church. And what's amazing is that now years ago when I first started teaching, I had just taught this work, and I went to Rome for the first time, and I was just walking around. It's sometimes nice when you're in a strange city to just, at least a city you don't know, just to walk around and go into buildings and just like see stuff, just sort of wander. And one of the first buildings I wandered into was actually this one. And I thought, oh, this is unbelievable. I just taught this. I had no idea where it was. And here it is right above me. It's an incredible work. It's an incredible work of art. And one, again, that I have to show you in the space first to really understand it. So this is the dome of the church. All of this is architecture. This is real architecture. This is the church on the outside. These are real windows emanating real light from the outside. But everything else, all of this in the center, this is all painting. This is all Pozzo's glorification of St. Ignatius. So just at the level of the technical feat of executing this painting is just incredible, because you see how he's used single point perspective, which you all know how that unfolds on a picture plane now. You see how he's used single point perspective. All these colonnades that are not real, this is all illusion, this is all painting, all these colonnades makes it feel as if the roof of the of this church has been blown off, that the that these columns are just shooting up into the sky, into the heavens. And they're doing so in such a way that fits perfectly with the actual space of the church. And I can attest to this. When you look up, you think, oh, wow, everything matches perfectly with the literal physical space of the church. What's even more incredible about this is that notice the ceiling itself is curved. This is all curved. And yet, the architecture and the painting all look straight and perfect. So this means he had to account for the curvature of the ceiling to make everything look as if it's straight. So if you're up there, if you were looking at it from, you know, the ceiling itself, everything would be wacky. It would be curved because it's accounting for the curvature of the ceiling itself. So it's an incredible, incredible work. And here it is, just the painting part itself. So in the center, you have Christ on a cross, sort of coming down. The heavens are opening up. You have Saint Ignatius on a cloud rising up to meet him. So Saint Ignatius, again, an important saint for the Baroque. He's the founder of the Jesuits. And the Jesuits went around to try to proselytize Christianity. And they didn't just push back against the Reformation. They went to lots of different places in the world. So this is during the era of exploration, of colonization, and of Western expansion and imperialism, and colonization, colonialism throughout the globe. This is a moment of these religious missions. which, truth be told, wreaked a lot of havoc on the non-Western peoples. And they are referenced in this painting. So you have Ignatius, you have Christ in the center, but on each side, the scene of angels and people floating up into heaven, it's as if Pozzo is trying to give you the whole Christian world, not only of Europe, of the Western world, but also other worlds that they're discovering and that they're now going out on missions to try to convert. So one is Asia down here. Here it is close up. So Asia, and here think more of, we would say, the Middle East, Northern Africa, Middle East. And so you have the camel here as a sign of that, and this sort of orientalizing, these orientalizing tropes in the painting itself. You have Africa here in the center. So, you know, there's a clear racialization of the other as denoting Africa in this passage of the painting. You have America. And so here, I think this is very obvious. You have a mountain lion, and you have First Nations, a Native American, with a spear in the center. And then you have Europe, a personification of Europe with a horse on the other side. So you put it all together, and it's basically, you know, the ambitions of the Catholic Church proselytizing throughout the world. And of course, again, in the center, you have St. Ignatius himself, the founder of these Jesuits, and Christ floating with a cross in the center. So, leaving aside the iconography, leaving aside the story, which in some ways is problematic, it's a really beautiful, incredibly well-executed work of art. And I find this work to work so well with Baroque music. So it's in the Baroque period. There's all sorts of wonderful classical music that comes before the Baroque. But if you're not into classical music and you want to broaden your horizons a little bit, after all, the more things you can love and be interested in the world, the more the world has to offer. The Baroque is one of those places to start. One of those desert island composers, the one that you have to choose. If you have to choose five composers, if you're going to be thrown on a desert island somewhere, be aware you might get sick of like some pop music that we listen to that may very well be fun, but after a while you might get sick of it, as we usually do. But if you pick Bach, if you pick Johann Sebastian Bach, you likely will never get sick of Bach because it's so complicated and so intricate and so beautiful and interesting. And Bach would be the major Baroque composer, the one I would say, yeah, that's the one you want to learn about in the Baroque. Funny I say all that, because what I'm going to play for you now is not Bach, but it's Vivaldi. And Vivaldi's also a really wonderful Baroque composer. But he wrote a mass, and this is the Gloria from that mass, and it's just a really beautiful piece of music, also very Baroque, in the way it sort of tugs at you emotionally. It sort of it travels quite a bit as a piece of music, and it just fits really well with this work of art. So I always play this in the classroom, and then usually have people sort of talk about it and compare the music with the painting. So we won't be doing that, obviously, but why not get a chance to listen to some new music? That's never a bad thing. So here's Vivaldi. Thank you. So let's move on. This is the last feature of the Baroque that we're gonna talk about, and it's one of the most beloved painters, really almost of any era, and that's Caravaggio. And Caravaggio, there are some things that are quite similar in Caravaggio with what we've talked about. So he's definitely Baroque. So it's gonna be very dramatic. It's gonna be lack the kind of clarity that you might have seen in the High Renaissance in some ways, to really controversial effects. And you are going to feel like you're being sucked in to the painting. But with Caravaggio, there's also a new style that we're seeing. It's much darker. It's much more gritty. There's a realism in Caravaggio that you don't find, let's say, in a Bernini or a Pozzo, where everything is idealized and very beautiful. In Caravaggio, you're getting the sense that you're actually seeing the sort of low down, very dingy, lower class spaces of Rome in a way that no painter had ever really introduced into art. So he's actually really quite controversial. People called him the Antichrist of painting. Some people really revile Caravaggio, found his paintings to be too violent, too dark, too gritty, too part of like the real world, not idealized enough. And he was a bit of a hothead. He was very, he didn't just depict, let's say, lower classes and sort of people that go to bars late at night and get into fights and that sort of thing. He actually did all these things. He may even have killed somebody, which I think involved a tennis match or something like that, and had to leave Rome because he was being looked for by the authorities. So a really tumultuous, borderline, maybe not borderline, criminal life that Caravaggio lived. And so this is amazing because what I'm describing to you is a really sort of low down, very tumultuous person in Caravaggio, who's giving you these paintings that are very dark, very dingy, almost like you can smell, I don't know if you ever walked by bars in like the East Village or something like that, but you can almost, it's like the, it's wood and beer, the smell of wood and beer that like they can't clean away. It's just in the air and even comes out into the sidewalk. You're getting that sense from some of Caravaggio's paintings. So you have that, but on the other hand, they're incredibly pious. They're all about conversion stories. They're all Christian, right? So there are some scholars that say that Caravaggio, through his painting, and he's one of the most gifted painters in history, he was sort of atoning for his life that was a bit, let's say, more sinful in the eyes of the more genteel and of the authorities. So this is Caravaggio. He's sort of a contradictory figure. Whatever the case may be, he's an incredible painter. And for us, it's not so controversial to see a painting that might be dark and brooding and dingy and dirty and evoking this type of realism. And so I have a couple of examples for you. This is The Calling of St. Matthew, very Baroque, because this is a conversion story. This is Matthew, who's a tax collector. And sometimes it's debated as to which one Matthew is. I like to think it's this guy. And it looks like they're gambling. It looks like he's a bit drunk. Some people say it's the guy who might be pointing to himself, but I think actually he's more pointing to Matthew. So you have these guys who are around the table, probably drinking beer, having a bunch of drinks and gambling. And all of a sudden walks in this figure, an older man. And then behind this older man is this guy. And at first you think, you don't know, like maybe you can't quite recognize what it is. And this is what upsets so many people. But you get a sliver of a halo here from this very dramatic light and relief that's coming in from the outside. It's actually Christ. It's a depiction of Christ, who's calling out this tax collector, St. Matthew, who will then become converted as one of his disciples, right? So you're seeing a conversion story, but one in this really sort of dive bar. It's quite incredible. And Christ, the most important figure for Christians and for Catholics, is sort of relegated to the right side. Even like you almost can't notice that it's him. And he's behind this other figure that he's walking in with. So very unorthodox, definitely for the time, and very dark, very dingy, this high level of realism. So some people hated Caravaggio, but other people found it really exciting. And Caravaggio will become a whole style unto itself. So here's another version. Here's another famous work by Caravaggio, The Conversion of St. Paul, another conversion. St. Paul, so important for the history of Christianity. He's the one who goes all over the place to sort of spread the news. But of course, before he becomes St. Paul, he's just Saul, a Roman soldier, on his way to Damascus. When he's blinded by this light and he falls off his horse and he's converted to St. Paul. So again, this miraculous conversion story being put to paint here by Caravaggio. And once again, he's done it in a way that's very unorthodox and in a way that upset quite a bit of people. So if I didn't tell you what this story is, you would have thought, well, this is just almost like slapstick, the guy who'd fallen off his horse, and now he's on the ground. You wouldn't have necessarily known this was even a Christian painting. So this high level of realism. And notice how compositionally you're almost falling into the space with him. It's so up in your face, and you're getting this slight vantage point from the top, or at least from an angle that's a little bit up to the top, so that it's almost like you're falling into this painting, which is, again, very, very Baroque. You also have this important figure for Catholics, St. Paul, on the ground, and he's blinded, so you do have, and you have the light, so you do have this iconography of the conversion story. But nonetheless, two-thirds of the painting is taken up by the horse, who looks like he's about to actually maybe step on St. Paul, or Saul, who's been converted, and he's only being handled by, bridled by a handler here, right? So the horse is almost more of a point of emphasis in this painting, and it's an incredible horse, than St. Paul himself, who only seems to take up maybe like a third, maybe a little bit more than a third of the painting. So compositionally, very unorthodox, and definitely stretching the limits of what was possible in paint at that time. There is a way we can explain, and this is a very funny story. This is a history of trolling in art. So Caravaggio was enlisted to do two paintings in this chapel in Rome. One of them was the martyrdom of St. Peter, and it's over here, so we don't really study it, so I don't show it to you, but it is here, and St. Peter is being, we may actually have talked about this in class, if my memory serves me right, and a student in class actually knew this, and talked about it, and told us about it. So in the history of Catholicism, St. Peter is martyred, he's killed by Romans, and they want to crucify him, but he says, I'm not fit to die like Messiah, so please crucify me upside down. So Caravaggio is showing you this moment where St. Peter is being crucified upside down. Really dramatic moment. Then facing that is the painting that we just looked at. So this is the conversion of St. Paul. And this is where things get funny, because this is Carracci, an artist very different from Caravaggio, I think you can tell, like very pastel-y, beautiful, bright colors, much more idealized. It's still a bit more in the High Renaissance here. Caravaggio hated him. So he knew where his painting was going to be in relation to the Carracci, so he made the horse basically show his butt, like his behind would be facing Caracci's painting here. So this is, you know, this is almost like a dirty joke. This is very Caravaggio. This is a moment of trolling in art history. But it's a nice one to show in context, even if it is like, like a bit juvenile. I don't remember if this is in your book, but I've always loved this Caravaggio. I think it's one of his more incredible paintings. And it's also very, very Baroque, because it's so fleshy, it's so physical and visceral. You almost, whenever I look at this painting, you almost get like this response. Like, it's unbelievable to see this guy put his finger into the wound here of this body. It's just so visceral and affective. So it is Christ, and it's the story of St. Thomas, who didn't believe that he had resurrected. And so Christ puts his finger into his wound to sort of prove this tangible proof, confirming the belief that he was actually resurrected. And notice, like, these, even Christ is not idealized, and the St. Thomas and these other disciples around him, they look like workers. They look like they've had a long life. They have a lot of wrinkles. They seem a bit dirty. Their clothes are in tatters. This is some of like the best of Caravaggio. He was really using almost low down, run of the mill sort of lower class people in these incredibly important religious paintings, which again would have upset a lot of people. But it's a very new vision of what painting can do. And again, this is dramatic lighting. You're forced right into this scene. It's almost like you become St. Thomas, and Caravaggio is the painter that sort of is trying to prove to you that this flesh, that this scene actually exists. It's a pretty incredible painting. And our last example for the Baroque. Finally, we get to a woman in history. This is Artemisia Gentileschi, who still at this moment, women wouldn't be allowed to study paint. But she had a liberal father who was also a painter, who taught her how to paint. And she became better than her father, and in fact became a very well-known artist. And she was into the Caravaggio-esque. Caravaggio himself, it becomes a style. So this very dark, brooding style, everything that you know about Caravaggio that we just went through, is represented here. And this is another religious scene. Judith and her maidservant slaying Holofernes. This is from Judaism. This is Holofernes, a king who was coming in, who was about to take over the Hebrews. And in order to save her people, Gentileschi sneaks in to his camp and seduces him to a certain degree. And once he sort of he lets down his guard, a servant comes out with a sword and gives it to Judith, and she cuts his head off. So this is that really dramatic moment. It's pretty grisly, where the head is being cut off, blood is sort of spurting forth from his neck and already sort of dribbling down on the sheets. So that's the story. But I think you can tell the style, the aesthetic of this is very Caravaggio, very dramatic. This intense lighting, everything sort of pushed up into your face. Very much part of the Baroque on the Caravaggio side of things. Okay, so let's take our break, and when we get back, we'll talk about the Enlightenment, neoclassicism, and the age of reason.